Short history of philosophical interventions into religious discourse as they developed in early modernity and on through Hegel and young Hegelian thought will make a mark at Marx, but of course all of the presentations will have his shadows cast upon them by Marx. So with us today are Mirko Mel from the left, assistant at cultural studies in the faculties of social science in the University of Ljubljana. He published many books on the philosophy of touch and will be speaking today on the curious history of the idea of the invisible hand from Malebranche to the present via, of course, the famous Adam Smith passage. Next is Jernej Kaluža. He's a doctoral candidate at philosophy, doing his thesis on Deleuze at the Faculty of Arts in Ljubljana. He's a radio student journalist and an organizer at Autonomous Center ROG. Next is our own program board member of ILS, Martin Hergel. He's also a doctoral candidate at philosophy of arts, doing his thesis on Hegel, Marx, and subjectivity. He will be speaking on the way critique of religion in Enlightenment transformed into social critiques in Marx and how this developed during young Hegelianism. And last but not least is also a doctoral candidate at Villanova University, Rachel O'Miller, who will be speaking, who has her thesis on comic angst and will be speaking on capitalism and how religious affect was debated upon in debates in young Hegelianism and in young Marx. So we'll start from the same order just mentioned, starting with Mirt. The word is yours.
Thank you. Okay, the invisible hand of the market from Malebranche to Adam Smith. Before I go to the object of my inquiry, I have since we're going to talk about economy, politics, and religion, I would like to start with a confession. I stole the title of this paper from Aaron Schuster's lapsus during his paper presentation at the conference on sexuality precisely 1 year ago, held at the SAS organized by Ljubljana's Lekanian School. But since we are the May Day school, and considering that not only Marx unmasked property rights as a bourgeois invention, also Hegel before him sentenced that we all drain from the same cup of the spirit, I consider myself absolved of this sin and can now proceed almost guilt-free towards the object of my inquiry. The concept of touch in the metaphor of the invisible hand of the market, addressed, since everybody knows that Adam Smith knows Adam Smith as the father of this metaphor, but almost nobody knows that the grandfather was Nicolas Malebranche. Let me first take you into a short trip, a very short trip, into the one chapter of the otherwise long philosophical history regarding touch. Touch as such became the focus of philosophical questioning only recently, especially due to the works of Jean-Luc Nancy and Jacques Derrida. But even before them, of course, it did not go unnoticed. Just some decades earlier, Maurice Merleau-Ponty wrote his best-known works, The Phenomenology of Perception, and his posthumous Visible and Invisible, both addressing from here and there the issue of touch. In the former, he displays the conception of intentionality from consciousness towards the body, while in the latter, he predefined the bodily experience through the concept of flesh, understood as a kind of tactility that precedes any given touch, the tactile condition of possibility of touch and touching. The most direct confrontation with touch comes in the very last chapter of The Visible and Invisible, entitled The Interwining, the chiasm, deriving the term from the Greek letter chi, because of its graphic representation of the crossing over of two dimensions, subjective and objective, embodied in the concept of share or flesh, an ultimate notion, as Merleau-Ponty himself says, a concrete emblem of a general manner of being which provides access both to subjective experience and objective existence. Now the experience he discusses is the one that figures already at the beginning of the phenomenology of perception, namely that of touching one hand with the other, as singular experiment which everybody can try during this time. Thus flashes from Merleau-Ponty not only the medium of touching, but also provides a tactile experience of the world as something tangible, while the relationship between the two is, considering the example of the hand that touches the other hand, also reversible. The hand that touches can be felt as touched, and vice versa, to never both at the same time, and this is the chiasm on a level of touch, very simply put. Now the whole concept, the whole point of the concept of flesh as modeled around the problem of tactility is that it is something prior, that there is something prior to the act of touching and being touched, something that not only becomes and comes before the subject, but also constitutes the subject's tactility. And it is in this regard that Judith Butler, in her book about senses of the subject, puts the following question in Merleau-Ponty's mouth. Is the subject formed from tactility, or perhaps more precisely, how is the subject formed by a touch that belongs to no subject? And moreover, what does it mean that it can be named but not found, that it eludes touch, as it were, when we try to lay hold of it? What is it about touch that eludes our touch, that remains out of our reach? In short, touch cannot be touched. That is the implication of Butler's questioning of Merleau-Ponty's phenomenology of the body. However, in order to gain an answer, she gives up searching the above-mentioned two books and goes back to an earlier set of lectures by Merleau-Ponty from 47-48, transcribed by Jean Dupron, under the title L'Union de la main de Ducorps chez Malebranche, Birao and Bergson. Now, Nicolas Malebranche, I think he needs a little contextualizing because he's a very obscure 17th century oratorian priest and theological philosopher from Paris who wanted to merge Augustine's and Descartes' works in order to demonstrate his God's omnipresence in the world. Now, Malebranche's theological work had no real impact on later on philosophy, except for the influence on Bishop Berkeley, who in turn awoke Kant from his dogmatic sleep. That line is clear, at least that. Malebranche was considered a facile and flat response to Descartes' mind-body dilemma. Vessel and flight, at least if compared with Spinoza's answer, best exemplified with the sentence from the second definition of the first part of his Ethics, the all-known, the body does not limit the mind, nor does the mind limit the body. Now, to be sure, Malebranche, in his dialogues on metaphysics, argued that the mind cannot influence the body, nor the body can influence the mind, and that neither of them can be the cause for any action, since the summa causa of all things can only be God. When I will, for instance, that my hand should shake hands with another person, my volition is the occasion or the occasional cause of the movement of my arm. The efficient cause of both my volition and the movement of my arm is God. And those occasions which we have to unwillingly shake hands only proves his points. And hence, Malebranche, the occasionally gets 1 point. We can grant him that. One of his key sentences that Merleau-Ponty quoted during his above-mentioned lecture on the unity of the body and the soul is actually an autobiographical note. Malebranche writes, "I can feel only what touches me." Now, by making a juxtaposition consisting of this Malebranche quote and the famous one made by Descartes apropos the, I think, the 4 a.m., Judith Butler displaces in a very Merleau-Pontyan fashion the primacy of the thinking eye towards a touch that precedes any given sensorial eye. Even before becoming the autobiographical statement of the eye stating that I can feel only what touches me. And thus touch becomes, with Merleau-Ponty and even more so with Judith Butler, a formative experience, as if the body is touched by something other than itself, even before becoming the mute it of the speaking self. However, if I can only feel I can feel only what touches me, it doesn't mean I can touch it back. God, as far as Malebranche's theological argument goes, is stricto sensu untouchable. Now, I would like you to recall the famous fresco from La Cappella Sistina, sealing La Creazione di Adamo by Michelangelo, and I'm referring, of course, to the painter, not to the turtle. In this painting, God is elevated by a cushion of angels vigorously stretching his mighty fingers towards Adam's slightly bent human hand, that is at the point of receiving life, since, unlike the situation of shaking hands, the two, God and man, are not equals. And apropos this inequality, I have one more Christian fairy tale to tell, since all outside is very Christmas-like, before sailing towards at least a little more salty secular waters, namely the story about Job. In the first chapter, we can read, in the land of Uz, there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. As a true proto-capitalist, he also owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 donkeys, and had a large number of servants. Now, one happy day, a bunch of angels came to visit God, to make a long story short, take some tea and biscuits, talk about everything and nothing, and so on. But the communistic Satan was among them and successfully invoked God's vanity by provoking him in this way. He said to him, "Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hands so that his flocks and herds are spread through the land. But now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." And then Lord said to Satan, "Very well then, everything he has is in your power, but on the man himself do not lay a finger." Satan happily unleashed every possible evil on Job's property, but good old Job did not bend and curse God as people nowadays do. And the next day, and in the next chapter, the same scene with the angels and God and Satan repeats, only this time with an upgrade, by Satan saying, "Skin for skin, a man will give all he has for his own life, but now stretch out your hand and strike his flesh and bones, and he will surely curse you to your face." To which the Lord replied, "Very well then, he is in your hands, but you must spare his life." And he proceeds in doing just so. If the destruction of all his property did not shake the man, the desecration of his body surely did a better job. A lengthy series of speeches follow with Job arguing against God in front of his so-called friends, and he doesn't shut up until the Lord himself shows up from a stormy sky, to which Job replied, "I am unworthy. How can I reply to you? I put my hand over my mouth." At the very end of this very angry speech, the Lord gives Job for all the unfair trouble by doubling his property, so that now he, as we can read in the end of the story, he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. Nothing is said about the servants anymore. Moral of the story, the hand that took all of Job's possession and desecrated his body now gave him back even more than he had at the beginning, just for indulging in a demonstration of how man can be touched by God and at the same time unable to touch his divine intangibility back. Now, after this more or less entertaining Christian moral tale about God's touch, let's move to, finally, to Adam Smith's moral philosophy and his inquiry into the nature and causes of the wealth of nations, where the invisible hand appears only once in the whole book and only twice more in his whole opus. The fourth book of The Wealth of the Nation is dedicated to the system of political economy, starting with a chapter on the principle of the commercial or mercantile system, followed by the chapter about restraints upon importation from foreign countries of such goods as can be produced at home, where we can find this famous metaphor at work. The context is not irrelevant, I think, at least according to certain scholars. Smith derived the meaning of the metaphor from Richard Cantillon, who was an Irish-French economist and author of an essay sur la nature du commerce en général, while the metaphor itself was a recurrent theological motif of the period, referring to the before-mentioned God's mighty finger. Now, in the above-mentioned second chapter of the book 4, Adam Smith questions a country's monopoly of home market and the benefits that comes with it, starting by stating as axiom that, I quote, "the general industry of the society can never exceed what the capital of the society can employ, and that every individual is continually exerting himself to find out the most advantageous employment for whatever capital he can command. It is his advantage, indeed, and not that of society which he has in view." A little further on, he develops the argument in favor of this egoistic view of trade. The individual, quote again, "generally indeed neither intends to promote the public interest, nor knows how much he is promoting it. He intends only his own security, and by directing that industry in such a manner as it's produced, may be of the greatest value, he intends only his own gain, and he is in this, as in many other cases, led by an invisible hand to promote an end which was no part of his intention. In short, the individual, by pursuing his own egoistic interest through an economic roundabout led by an invisible hand, actually benefits society even more if we read further on, his efforts will be directly directed toward this goal. So the position is very clearly marked by Smith. The metaphor of the invisible hand therefore functions in both ways. The hand in question not only magically transforms the purely egoistic drives into a source of common welfare, it also, mutatis mutandis, even challenges every action that is or could be directly oriented toward the improvement of society as doubtful. Now, if you pay attention, Smith's trick is really something like a magic trick, and therefore let me recall the three parts of every great magical trick as rendered by the famous quote from the movie Prestige. The first part is called the pledge. The magician shows you something ordinary, a deck of cards, a bird or a man. He shows you this object. Perhaps he asks you to inspect it to see if it is indeed real, unaltered, normal. But of course it probably isn't. We have in Smith's case a very ordinary individual, a businessman, a society, a market, an economy, a country, and so on. The second act is called the turn. The magician takes the ordinary something and makes it do something extraordinary. This is the egoistic individual tendency to engage in trade, command and employ labor and capital, maximize his own profit, ensure his own security. And now the third part. Now you're looking for the secret, but you won't find it, because of course you're not really looking. You don't really want to know. You want to be fooled. But you won't clap yet, because making something disappear isn't enough. You have to bring it back. That's why every magic trick has a third act, the hardest part, that part we call the prestige. And this is the extraordinary turn that the very ordinary egoistic tendencies turn out to be in fact the most altruistic ones that benefit society as a whole. What disappeared into the individual capital reappears as the wealth of nations. Now, where is the trick? If you pay attention, you notice that Smith, in the above mentioned quote, does not actually say the individual is like as if he was led by an invisible hand, but rather states plain and simply and very directly, while pursuing his goal, he is led by an invisible hand to promote an end which was not part of his intention. The trick is that the invisible hand is not a metaphor at all. That is his magical trick. Not a metaphor, but rather the very hand of God intervening in the middle of a market economy, touching upon individuals and leading their egoistic actions towards the benefits of society. Now, despite the still palpable theological roots of Adam Smith's conception, and despite the fact he never employed directly the paradigm itself, his invisible hand became the invisible hand of the market during the 19th century, and as it is employed nowadays, which refers mainly to the laissez-faire policies of the state. Smith's magical invisible hand sustained at least two significant changes. First, it secularized from the sacral touch of God into the market's touch, that if unrestrained from the state defines the best average prices, make the best entrepreneur destroy the other, and so on, much in tune with the Book of Job story, while still intervening in the role of Malebranche's touch of God. And second, it lost the subjective moral component regarding the individual egoistic intentions turning out to be altruistic deeds, while retaining the laissez-faire argument, an argument against the monopoly of the market by the state, nothing said about the other forms of monopoly, not state-owned. Now, I will not engage in the whole history of economic debates about the invisible hand, but rather, in order to slowly conclude, I would try to think how does touch function if led by the invisible hand of the market. Despite the fact that the prevalent contemporary merchandise is composed of audiovisual material, touch is nevertheless a valuable commodity. Think only about the list one can make about how touch sells in the market, especially in touch-based technology. For instance, Apple's first iPhone from 2007 was promoted with slogans such as Apple reinvents the phone, and this is only the beginning. Both slogans pertaining to the newly introduced touchscreen technology. An anecdote, a curious anecdote about the presentation of the first touchscreen iPhone came when Steve Jobs showed the device to reporters during a media tour in the same year, 2007, and there was one journalist who criticized the touchscreen keyboard. "It doesn't work," he said, adding that he kept making typos and the keys were too small for his thumbs. And Jobs stopped for a moment, tightened his head and replied, "Your thumbs will learn." And all of our thumbs, of course, did learn with this technology, adapting to a new virtual touch that promises more vicinity, more contact, as in the Nokia slogan from the 90s, "Keep in touch," but achieved the very opposite, a further estrangement from each other and more attachment to technology itself. Now, considering the progress in touch technology, we could sketch a three-stage development in this sense. First, they sold us mobiles with added value, touchscreen iPhone. Then they sold us the trademark, only Apple that counts. And in the last stage, they are selling us apps with this useless gadget called mobile phone nobody really uses because everything else is more useful. That's the last stage. The aufhebung of the mobile phone into this technology. Even before becoming part of the nowadays prevalent mobile technology, touch was of course sold in many different ways, especially in the so-called oldest trade, prostitution. If you consider the expressions used when selling their singular services, we can see how the language used never pertained to the whole body, but rather its touching parts. Anal sex, oral sex, plain sex, handjob, blowjob, etc. The list is long. As if the body is deconstructed into singular objects of touch and then sold on the allegedly free market. Everything in prostitution proceeds completely in tune with what Lacan said about l'objectia, the object reason of desire, namely that it is a partial object that does not exist, but nevertheless insists in producing, and in this insisting produces a surplus of pleasure. A concept that was inspired in the 17th seminar by Marx's definition of surplus value, in the sense that both surpluses have in common that they have no direct usage and therefore form the very core of what we refer to when we refer to values. As far as moral values goes, we should refrain from moralizing about prostitution by remembering what Marx said in on the topic. Quoting from the Economic and Philosophical Manuscripts of 1844, "Prostitution is only a specific expression of the general prostitution of the worker, and since it is a relationship in which falls not the prostitute alone, but also the one who prostitutes, and the latter submission is still greater, the capitalist also comes under this head. In short, if it is a shameful occupation, it is so because all work is shameful, including the intellectual one. And in this sense, as work, considering all this, therefore, thanks God if he exists, that we are participating at least here at the May Day School for free, not paid. And to conclude, what does Malebranche, Touch of God, the Biblical Book of Job, Adam Smith's Invisible Hand, and Steve Jobs' Touch Technology, the prostitute's hand job, have all in common? And the answer is, it's all a fucking job. Thank you.
Presentation is excessive affirmation of God as a way towards atheism. I will begin with some very basic remarks that I found fundamental for this panel as a whole. It is well known that Marx's critique of capitalism as a productive system is deeply connected with his critique of religion, or more precisely, one of the first direct assaults on religion as a whole, its social function and authority in Western history, provided by young Hegelians such as Feuerbach or Stirner, presents foundation for later critique of capitalism. This is not the first critique of Catholic religion in general, but, at least I think so, one of the first direct attacks on it from an absolutely external perspective. This was a part of a much greater movement of thought which began to doubt in God from the perspective of atheism. Before that, being an atheist was mainly an assault directed to others to exclude them. For example, a person that is now known as one of the greatest atheists in the history of Western thought, Baruch de Spinoza, that lived in the century, he didn't recognize himself as an atheist. In general, we could trace this great historical break between the end of 18th century and the first half of the 19th century. Only since then, total external critique of religion was discursively possible. Kant and Hegel, for example, they both, even if they perceived themselves as enlightened rationalists, at the end of the day affirmed established religion, its morality and its customs, and tried to show that it is in accordance with reason. After that, religion as a whole became a problem, as an institution and as a practice with its socio-political effects. Religion is a lie, opium for the people, and so on. It should be abandoned and replaced with something completely else: liberalism, atheism, materialism, and so on. Many questions arise here. Should this other thing that will replace religion imitate its form, its social function? Is the problem this form itself? Will this substitution of religion sooner or later itself start to function as a religion, and so on? Anyway, today I will go deeper in another model of religious disobedience. This is an internal critique of religious authorities that was more common in the earlier period. Those times, in general, were not ready for a direct atheistic statements. On the contrary, critique of religion could only be possible inside a sphere of religion. Direct atheistic ideas mainly remain obscure, hidden, and judged. The general form of an internal critic was constructive. It presented itself as a benefit for religion itself. For example, concrete religious practices are not religious enough, they are not in accordance with God's nature. You religious people, you don't know how perfect God is, how great is His nature. That is why you are not acting in accordance with it. I'm interested in that sort of a critic. It is a very funny thing for me, at least when I read some of those texts, for example, David Hume. You know him, he's a total skeptic, to say it shortly. It is not just that he doesn't believe in God, he doesn't believe in anything. He even doubts if the sun will rise tomorrow. And this is not a joke. He explicates this thesis with a great rigorosity. And when he came to God, he doesn't say just that we can only speculate about him and his nature, that his existence cannot be in any way achieved through our existence, but also says that this and only this is in accordance with Christianity. Quote, "Only person that is mature for the true sense of imperfection of our mind would be open for revelation. On the other side, presumptuous dogmatic will be sure that he can build the whole system of theology only with the help of philosophy. Being a philosophical skeptic for an educated person therefore presents first and the most essential step towards a stage of healthy, faithful Christian." It is something very clever about this argumentation that is also at the same time the most scandalous thing about for religious authorities. It implies that no one, even religious authority, cannot know anything about God, because God reveals himself only in a form of totally unexpected and unpredictable miracle. Spinoza, on the other hand, takes totally opposite direction, but nevertheless his argumentation has the same effects as Hume's. Spinoza's argumentations go, if God is perfect and omnipresent, how can we think that he revealed himself by unnatural miracles that are seen only to certain people? God does not reveal himself only to certain people, nation, social class, or institution. Knowledge of God is the same as knowledge of nature. God is inscribed in nature and in human mind. He can be equally accessible for everyone. God acts completely inside the sphere of this world. His will is materialization of world. Spinoza's theory of God is affirmation of materialism. We cannot presuppose that a part of God is outside or above physical world, because this would imply his imperfection and inability of being realized. God is material means that no one has any privilege in regard to God. Spinoza is religious atheist, not because he would deny God, but because religious authorities understood him as an atheist. And why they couldn't stand this Spinoza's theory? Simply because it introduces the idea of equality in religion that contradicts with their religious power. Spinoza says, we are all equally perfect, we are explications of God, God is equally implicated in us. Another thing is that we cannot understand the controversy of his theory if we don't presuppose deep linkage between religion and power, between religious authorities and civil power in those times. Even if you look on a larger scale, for example, at the medieval religious disputes about the body of Christ, about angels, and about which saint is more important, you can see in each of these cases that those disputes are always deeply connected with concrete power relations, with jurisdiction on certain territory, or with concrete alliances between religious and civil authorities. Spinoza was always a delinquent in this context. He simply didn't want to obey. Later I will explain why. Because of his beliefs, he was first excluded from Amsterdam Jewish community, then he was hated by Calvinists and exiled from Amsterdam, and so on. At the end of his life, when he was partly recognized as a legitimate philosopher and not only as a blasphemous atheist, he received an offer for the chair of philosophy at the University of Heidelberg. He refused it because of the possibility that it might in some way trouble his freedom of thought. In the invitation is written that, I quote, Prince has confidence that Spinoza would not misuse his freedom in philosophical teaching to disturb the public religion. Freedom in the closed philosophical bubble was therefore not a problem, as long as it doesn't touch public religion, as long as it doesn't try to have an influence on established order, morality and tradition that are very ground for a civil authority. Religion is namely one of the main spheres where established power gains its legitimation from the perspective of the multitude of believers. It functions as a link between people and authorities. It controls public behavior, it has a direct impact on people's gestures, it makes them predictable. Even Spinoza's theological political treatise was, for example, written in the context of concrete political conflict in Holland in those times. On the one hand, you had the monarchical tendencies of the House of Orange, on the other, republican tendencies that were in favor of free market, of independent and separated provinces, especially merchants and upper classes. The main question was separation, autonomy, or unification and centralization. Separation was in accordance with freedom in religious affairs, while on the other side, monarchical power found in uniform and dogmatic religion its natural ally. Of course, Spinoza was a republican, but he didn't decide to add one more political pamphlet to the multitude in which the principle of freedom of thought and speech had already been ably defended on general philosophical and humanitarian grounds. Religious fanatics were deaf and blind to such arguments. To them, philosophy meant heresy and humanism meant atheism. The citadel of the clerics was the Bible. Spinoza decided to turn his attention to this citadel itself. Spinoza's decision is, at least for me, very interesting in terms of political strategy. He didn't decide for an external attack, because this was exactly the tactic of religious authorities, to exclude, to externalize any heresy and any disagreement and to present it as an atheism, as something blasphemous and even evil, unhuman. This was a way for a discreditation of such opinions in front of public. Spinoza chooses internal dispute. He tries to show that the very Bible on which these presumptuous theologians base their whole case did not bear them out at all, that they were simply ignorant of these very scriptures, Bible, and that they used religion and the Bible merely as a cloak for their own impudent lust for power over others. Spinoza's argumentation is very simple and it presents a very clever attack on religious authorities. The main rule of the interpretation of Bible is that everyone should, not only should but also must, understand Bible exactly and in a way as he wants to understand it. Quote, For since the supreme authority for the interpretation of scripture is vested in each individual, the rule that governs interpretation must be nothing other than the natural light that is common to all, and not any supernatural light nor any external authority. This brings us to a very strict alternative. If you are trying to force the right interpretation and exclude the wrong, God is not with you and you don't understand him. That was, of course, a really direct provocation to religious authorities. Quote, how can you say we are experts and God's law is with us? That means even if you have scripture, you are lying that you are having God's word because you just nullify it. In short, any imposed idea of God and his law is necessarily incorrect without regard to its content. Obeying without understanding is necessarily inadequate, or if we say the same thing from the opposite perspective, adequate ideas about God are necessarily non-mediated and non-commanded. We can see that there still is certain selection, and that Spinoza's idea that there is no religious authority does not imply the idea that all understandings of God's nature are correct or that we have total relativism in this sphere. Selection is just moved into another sphere. External selection is replaced by immanent selection. No one is excluded. Each believer can select what is in accordance with God. But I will return to this precise point about selection later. We can see that Spinoza introduces certain liberalization in the most sacred core of enemy's camp. He attacked dogmatism on its own ground. Spinoza is, in this context, almost a proto-anarchist, religious anarchist. He develops the thesis that rejects any kind of hierarchy, any kind of command or obedience in regard to religion. This thesis is strictly and consistently explicated from God's nature. We are all equal in front of God, we are all immanent to God, God does not exclude anyone, nothing is outside God. We will return to Spinoza shortly, but on this point I will draw a line. I think that this abstract alternative that I presented between internal and external critique, internal or external rebellion, is structurally crucial in our times. Jameson, Deleuze and Guattari and many others have namely further developed Marx's thesis that capitalism constantly appropriates its outside, that it doesn't have borders, or that it is deeply connected with imperialism, with a specific way of overpassing borders that are open for goods but not for people. In this sense, capitalism does not tolerate anything outside itself. On the other hand, it is also a well-known thesis that is in certain sense exquisite. You are easily excluded from the system, even if this exclusion is not based on some transcendental juridical authority, but on immanent selection of market itself. This ambivalence goes also through many current political debates on the left, to be outside or inside the system, state, parliament, to adapt and conform to the established structure and change it from the inside, or to invent a new form of a structure itself that presents as a counterpower. I will take as an example a concrete dispute in which I am partly involved, dispute between users of autonomous and squatted factory, Rock Factory in Ljubljana, and the Mol municipality of Ljubljana that wants to rebuild Rock Factory in a center for creative industries. Should users adapt to their discourse, start to talk how we are the most productive incubator of new ideas, how we contribute to city beauty, greenness, greatness and authenticity, or should we build totally external and critical discourse about how we are totally different and how we have nothing in common with intentions and ideas of city authorities? Should we present ourselves as a surplus value for a municipality or exactly as a resistance towards such a logic of gentrification where the only thing that counts is value? Should we adapt in a sense of legalization, bureaucratization and NGOization, or should we counter exactly those processes from the outside? Should we maybe even go in confrontation with legal jurisdiction, legislation and decrees of city authorities? And in this context, I found the idea of Spinoza's atheism that is at the same time excessive affirmation of religion and rebellion against it very interesting. Deleuze, in one of his lectures on Spinoza, said, quote, "Atheism has never been external to religion. Atheism is the artistic power at work on religion. With God, everything is permitted." Deleuze was a Spinozist, there is no doubt about that, and I read Spinoza through his appropriation. Especially when Deleuze speaks about the relation between rebellion and power, we can always find this logic of excessive affirmation at work. In Anti-Oedipus, for example, rebellion of a schizophrenic against psychoanalytic power doesn't take a form of an opposition or negation. Schizostatic is excessive affirmation, because, as we all know, through negation you cannot escape psychoanalytic power. If you say, for example, I dreamt something, but it wasn't about my father, mother, and so on. Schizo rather says, yes, of course, it's about my father, I identify with him, but my real father is Joan of Arc, Heliogabalus, Genghis Khan, Dionysus, and who not? Deleuze comments, quote, "Rather than everything being reduced to the name of father, the latter opened all the names of history. Every name in history is I. That is the same statement as there is no I. I am dispersed all around. You cannot catch me, codify and appropriate me to the Oedipus, daddy, mommy, me triangle." Spinoza's approach is the same. Yes, God is almighty, God is immanent, God is everything. He is in all of us. You shouldn't comment me who the real God or the real father is. Deleuze and Guattari subtitled Anti-Oedipus Capitalism and Schizophrenia because they see certain connection between the logic of both. They developed a thesis that capitalism should not be negated but affirmed in a very specific way. Capitalism tries to codify everything. Every new value is appropriated and put into the equalization with other values. But actual production of value is not a domain of capital itself, but of course, labor produces value. Capital presents itself as a productive only on a level of representation. In this context, is the logic of rebellion against capitalism the same as logic of rebellion of schizophrenic that I mentioned before. Quote, psychoanalysis constitutes for its part a gigantic enterprise of absorption of surplus value. But which is the revolutionary path? To withdraw from the world market, as Samir Amin advises third world countries to do? Or might it be to go in the opposite direction, to go still further, that is, in the movement of the market, of the coding and deterritorialization? For perhaps the flows are not yet deterritorialized enough, not decoded enough, from the viewpoint of a theory and a practice of a highly schizophrenic character. Not to withdraw from the process, but to go further, to accelerate the process, as Nietzsche put it. In this matter, the truth is that we haven't seen anything yet." End of quote. When I was preparing to this presentation and came to this idea of excessive affirmation of capitalism or religion, I was sure that I invented something new, and I happily announced this idea to Martin, and he said to me, "Yeah, very cool, that is called accelerationism. It's quite a trendy movement in the philosophy right now. Actually, it's already a little bit out of trend." And then I really read some of those literature and realized that idea of being faster than capitalism that was based on Deleuze and Guattari philosophy indeed isn't such a new idea. It is also a well-known where can we end up if we treat rebellion to capitalism as an excessive production of new values and new ideas, if we overestimate concepts such as creativity, inventiveness, production of novelty, and so on. Benjamin Noyce, he even coined the term Deleuzian Thatcherism to designate a specific alliance between the new right in economy on the one hand and the aims to abolish the state of any other external control over production and circulation based on the idea of acceleration of on the other side. My aim today is to present a specific reading of Deleuze and Spinoza excessive affirmation that can, or at least I think so, avoid such a naive stance that can be easily captured by neoliberalism. The structure of the solution is the following. acceleration of value must not be understood only in terms of quantity, but also in terms of quality, as a multiplication of forms that resist to an unification in a general value form that establish general and exchangeability. This critic, that Deleuze stated through Nietzsche toward establish religion and morality as a unificator of values, could also be stated towards capitalism. Capitalism only presents itself as a generator of difference, while it is a generator of uniformity. Guattari compares this process, where all the richness of difference is reduced to one value, to one thing, with the process of production of shit. Quote, When I talk about shit, it is hardly a metaphor. Capitalism reduces everything to shit, that is to say, to the state of undifferentiated and decoded streams out of which everyone has to take its part in a private mode and with a sense of culpability. I think that Spinoza's reading of Bible can prove useful in this context. He denies possibility of unification and affirms differences of interpretation. But, as I said earlier, his statement that everyone should understand God's word as he wishes should not be taken as an affirmation of simple relativism. There is a selection, but we cannot select and exclude from the outside on the level of words. We cannot define dogma. Debates about right and wrong predicates that we attribute to God is the same nonsense as a debate about which is the correct name of God. Selection could be performed only on the level of action, on the level of practice. Some acts are in accordance with God's nature and some are not. Quote, we cannot judge for anyone if he is faithful or not otherwise as from his actions. If his actions are good, even if the dogma doesn't conform to the dogmas of others, he is faithful. And if his actions are bad, even if he agrees in words with others, this person is not faithful to God. Selection is placed on the level of practice, because Spinoza believes in strict correspondence between theory and practice. Our action must be a result of our understanding of God. Our action cannot be defined as good if we don't understand what we are doing, if we are just following orders of religious authorities. Theory must be consistent with its practice in order to be consistent with itself. Religion is nothing if it doesn't imply an action that is in accordance with God. And if we look closely, this was exactly what Spinoza was constantly doing through his concrete life. He couldn't accept theory that does not have an impact on practice. He joins his theory with his practical political action. This is why he was so controversial for his opponents. This thing about selection implies a change of the whole structure of selection. We don't have religious authorities that can select on basis of dogma. What is good and what is bad action cannot be ordered. Selection is now placed in every individual that encounters others. These encounters are always immanently judged as either good or bad, and on this basis, individual has all the freedom to decide with whom he wants to cooperate. External selection is excluded and replaced with internal or immanent selection. And this, exactly this statement is Spinoza's selection, that he excludes external selection. Everyone affirms good action. That's in our nature. There is no need to command or control that selection. Even more, such an external selection will necessarily imply enforcement, inhibition, and break in flow of desire. Okay, we can see here that we have the most strict principle of free market of ideas in relation to God, and let's say also an invisible hand of God that function as a guarantee that God's will be realized. God is implicated in everything. His will is realizing. We shouldn't disturb it. We can definitely see closeness here with later developed historical liberalism, but I think that there exists also a small but very crucial difference. In economic liberalism, you always have exclusion and exclusivism. Everything is based on Smith's idea of trade between equals that is beneficial for all included parties. But this equality is based on appropriation of exteriority. It corresponds with the idea of brotherhood that is in competitive relation towards its outside, with the idea of equals that appropriate and codify new territory. Let's imagine brothers that are equal between each other, sit in front of a table and debate freely. All interpretations about how to exploit everyone who is outside the brotherhood are tolerated. They are debating about how to be in an adequate, harmonious relation with each other. That means how to make profit for all who are from all who are not included and for all who are included. They treat everything outside as a mere commodity. On the other hand, in the case of Spinoza, you by definition cannot tolerate any legitimation for exclusivism and exclusion in the system. God is univocal, that means it's equally accessible for everyone. God is immanent, absolute and perfect in itself beings. That means that it doesn't have an outside, negativity or any other form of otherness. This univocity doesn't have anything to do with unification or uniformation in a sense of quantitative or qualitative value in a sphere of a public morality or economy. On the contrary, it is a guarantee for difference in the Deleuzian sense, the difference that differentiates itself affirms itself. Difference cannot be compared between themselves, they cannot be identified, represented and unified. All interpretations of Bible are, at least in principle, equal. Every relation and every encounter between the equals and their interpretations develops its own good and bad. Every value is local, but not relative. It cannot be generalized, but it still could be precisely defined. For the very end, I will just like to say that, of course, we cannot apply this Spinoza's idea directly to the actual debate about less state or more state or something like that. But nevertheless, I think that if someone wants to think equality that is not controlled or forced, equality in the context of liberal and even anarchistic tradition, equality that excludes any master, any external planning of production, then it is necessary to follow Spinoza and exclude exclusion itself. Thank you.
Try to give a bit clearer insight into the vast field of pre-Marxian critique of religion. As noted in the abstract for the talk, this intellectual development that happened with Marx seems curiously abrupt. Marx famously, already quite early and more so as time passed, moved away from the critique of religion and more or less considered it a waning social force. However, in the decades just prior to that, theological and religion-related questions have been ubiquitous in fervent politically and socially charged debates. We had the conflict over atheism versus religion of supreme being during French Revolution, there was German Spinozismusstreit, and afterwards the general young Hegelian critical activity in 1830s and 1840s in Germany. In all these cases, the questions of whether there is God and how it should be conceived seem to be of great socio-political importance. So how exactly did it happen that this level of discourse so quickly and abruptly disappeared? To be manageably concise, I will of course have to limit my attention to just a tiny fraction of this theoretical movement and hope to give to it at least somewhat representative image. I will focus on two moments. First, some very general observation about the role, meaning and function of religion in Hegel's thought, and then I'll present the post-Hegelian development by focusing on the obviously linking author towards Marx with Feuerbach. So, what are the possible and, I believe, quite prevalent misconceptions about this theoretical development? Criticism of religion in Germany has been essentially completed, and criticism of religion is a precondition of all criticism. This Marxist judgment from the introduction to critique of Hegel's philosophy of right can be misleading. It seems to suggest some implicit theory of necessary historical stages of criticism upon which the historical forces of criticism must first thoroughly criticize religious illusions, and when these are dispelled, when eyes of the people are firmly fixed to the ground, then the criticism of the real thing of society can begin. Or, in other words, the essential misunderstanding or oversimplification that can arise here is that the pre-Marxian concern with religion, both critical and affirmative concern, is essentially a relic, a remnant of earlier pre-modern times. But it is a critical hobby of radical intellectuals that have not yet realized that they are living in capitalism, and they still fought the ghostly illusions of the past, even though those illusions supported some altogether different passing regime of oppression. I will show that the actual theoretic development is quite a bit more roundabout, more complicated. Namely, first of all, we should not conflate or confuse the young Hegelian critique of religion with the Enlightenment critique of religion. By Enlightenment critique, I roughly mean the 18th century critique that attacks the religion as some mindless dogma, total illusion, a superstition designed to hold people in subjugation of ancien regime with its stable hierarchies, divine right of the king, and prominent role of the church. So Enlightenment critique of religion is this definitely critique of pre-modern religion. But even in German version of Enlightenment, Aufklärung, which did proceed a bit different than, for example, in France, mostly because the Protestantism already itself included certain points of criticism that had to wait for Enlightenment in Catholic countries. But even the German version didn't have to wait until Feuerbach to get this, to absorb this Enlightenment critique of religion. I will argue that quite a bit earlier, this initial Enlightenment anti-Ancien regime critique of religion gave way to some to renewed positive evaluation of religion that essentially already took into account the modern context of early capitalism, but actually presupposed the context of early capitalism. And one of the exemplary cases of this passage is the development of Hegel's early thought. One of the first texts we have from Hegel is called Positivity of Christian Religion. Here the lines of polemic are drawn still roughly in the Enlightenment fashion with Protestant overtones. Positivity is here the antagonistic term. It means brute factuality of dogmas and practices that institutionalized Christianity demands. Religion is criticized as alienated institution, oppressive social phenomenon that rules with mindless laws and prescription that quite simply exist for the believers and they have to follow them without identification. Against the positivity of religion, Hegel at this stage demanded the subjective religion that can animate an individual to active life, to true engagement within society. And at this early stage, the historical references for such subjective religion were either early Christianity of Jesus or ancient Greek ethical life, Zizikait. So the living religion of reconciliation of particularity or universality, or of harmonious intertwinement of ethics and social life. For example, an interesting and illustrious quote from this era of Hegel. Subjective religion does not manifest its presence merely in putting the hands together, bending the knees, and abasing the heart before that which is holy. Rather, it spreads out into every budding branch of human impulse, without the soul being ever quite aware of it, and is everywhere active. So it immediately reminded me of that famous Althusser's paraphrase of Pascal. So it seems that Hegel was anti-Althusserian, early Hegel was anti-Althusserian far before Althusser was anti-Hegelian. But this early Hegelian position is worth mentioning primarily because of how it changed later on. This essentially anti-Ancien regime critique of positivity gave way to different concerns. Broadly speaking, Hegel became convinced that the harmonious ideal of ancient Greek society cannot be restored in modern times, and the development of his thoughts displayed gradual acceptance, positive re-evaluation of Christianity as a necessary element of contemporary social life. But now, not quite in the sense of completely discarding his earlier critique of positivity, but at least in acknowledging a certain level of objectivity of social institutions is necessary. And this reorientation was parallel to his increasing attention to emerging science of political economy and his acceptance of a certain historical necessity of early capitalist commercial society he witnessed around himself, along with the certain necessary level of social fragmentation it affected. The religion was here more and more assigned the role of being a counterweight to this centrifugal, fragmentic tendencies of commercial capitalist modernity. To get a better image why Hegel thought the religion is still needed, one has to take into account what would be the alternative principles of purely rational, in the sense of verstandig organization of social life. You either have on one side Kantian or maybe Fichtean pure universality of law, which Hegel criticized, that it remains external to the people, that is unable to provide guidance in critical social situation, and it's unable to provide motivation for action. And on the other hand, you had strictly instrumental rationality of the bourgeois with its narrowness, egoism, materialism, political apathy, immersion in private life without any impulse towards higher moral standing, without any sense of the universal. So anything, any other principle that gave the individual and his actions certain sense of totality, a sight of the absolute, already meant entrance to the level, to the indo realm of religion. So in this sense, I claim that the religious polemics of early 20th century were not pre-modern, but took reality of capitalism into account and were in a sense an attempt to offer an answer to this reality. Okay, now beyond this point, to try to present and to trace and present the complexity of Hegelian treatment of religion would be, of course, an intimidatingly huge task, so I will just conclude this presentation of his position with the following observation. Hegel's socio-political thought always remained within this tension between attentiveness to normal, particular, economical, everyday life and his simultaneous assertion that this life must be in some way connected or aspiring to the universal, the absolute, and that in the last instance meant divine, understanding of course that this Hegelian version of divinity is meant immanently, as realized in this world. Therefore, well, in this duality, Hegel's philosophy, however complete it aspired to be, always presented to its subsequent readers the following ambiguity. Does this immanent divinity mean secularization of idea of God, or a sacralization of secular life? And within this, with this ambiguity, the coordinates for the dynamics of German philosophy between Hegel and Marx, so for the split between conservative and liberal leanings of Hegel, were set. Therefore, as Walter Brueggemann shows in great detail and scope in his study called Marx, the Young Hegelians and Origins of Radical Social Theory, the crucial theological-political dilemma of post-Hegelian era was not about the existence or inexistence of God, but about his nature. More precisely, it was a dilemma between pantheistic conception of God, which is merely a name for totality of thing, to be very brief, and personalist conception of God, that is, conception of God as a person. And here, as Jarne previously showed, pantheism was the progressive egalitarianist option because it implied, you know, some nivellized, unifying political ontology. And on the other hand, personalism was the official theology of Prussian restorationism, as it fixed individuals in their distinct personality, because each person is image of God, and therefore isolated them from each other and put them in direct non-state relation to God. Now, in this context, we should now turn to reconsideration of Ludwig Feuerbach's work as a crucial link that led from Hegel to Marx. Now, Feuerbach is generally known for his break with Hegelian idealism and turn towards materialism in his most famous work, The Essence of Christianity, where he articulated a critique of religion based on the notions of projection and alienation. That is, he articulated the thesis that God is not an autonomous entity, but that God can govern lives of men only insofar as he is in fact a product of man in the first place, that God is man's misrecognition of his own essence, transplanted into some alien transcendence, that is, that God is man's own self-alienation. But if we try to understand this position as direct criticism of Hegel, it appears a bit strange, in a sense that it is far too close to some points that Hegel himself makes, only it is expressed in radically different vocabulary. To put it concisely, it would be nothing scandalizing for Hegel to hear that the conception or image of God is just a certain mode of self-recognition of man. Hegel just wouldn't see anything terribly wrong with such position. That religion is a phenomenon of spirit and that it is therefore always necessary, already caught up into the completely immanent dynamics of spirit, this is kind of obvious underlying feature of Hegelian thought. So for Feuerbach's position to make sense, to make historical sense, we cannot understand it as a direct criticism of Hegel. Instead, we have to follow the whole trajectory of his thought and understand it from its imminent theoretical context. Feuerbach started as critical, but still quite loyal student of Hegel. And what is most surprising, compared to his, if we take into account his later materialist turn, the surprising thing is that he affirmed precisely the most rationalistic elements of Hegelian thought. His doctoral dissertation was titled "Of Reason, One, Universal, and Infinite," and this is more or less the list of his favorite Hegelian notions in the early era. That is, he opposed the prevailing personalist religion with a certain Hegelian version of pantheism that was more rationalistic than naturalistic. Although already at this point he emphasized that this religion must be embodied in a concrete social collectivity, not some floating principle, but in the unity of species being gut and reason of humanity. And in his subsequent theoretical development, this essence of Gattungswesen, of species being slowly moved from emphasis on reason towards emphasis on the senselessness and corporeality. The early Feuerbach, with this emphatic affirmation of universality, attacked the personalist understanding of religion. He, for example, articulated his political religious goal as overthrowing from its throne the ego, the self in general. His perhaps the most directly anti-personalist work is Thoughts on Immortality and Personal God, which is quite clearly not just a theological dispute, but a critique of social consequences of personalism. Personalistically understood Christian faith atomizes, insofar as the idea of personality of God fixes individual as concrete person in its image and grants this person immortality, it isolates him in the relation to the absolute. It removes him from community through religion, which limits all that is essential to him, to himself, as atomized individual in relation to God. So, as Breckman knows, this book, Immortality and Personal God, is part of a certain important passage of thought, where for the first time, a certain ideological point that were until then exclusive to the conservative right, particularly to Catholic critique of Protestantism, namely, emphasize on community, on intrinsic sociality of human life, critique of liberalism and atomism, for the first time started in adjusted form appearing on the left of political spectrum. How did after this initial development, how Feuerbach emerged as radical materialist? It was a bit later on, in 1840s, after a decade of theoretical institutional struggles with the restorationist personalism, and the liberal side seemed to be losing in this struggle, particularly after arch-restorationalist Julius Friedrich Stahl replaced liberal Hegelian Eduard Ganz as the teaching post in Berlin. And only at this point, Feuerbach finally decided that Hegelian ambiguity regarding religion is, after all, itself guilty of the subsequent reactionary personalist theological thought, or at least it is not strong enough weapon against it, and more radical steps are needed. So he finally settled on the position that Hegelian transformation of God in the absolute spirit, in the principle of identity of thought and being, the principle of universal mediation, does not, after all, get rid of God, but that this thinking remains thoroughly theological, and that the only way out is to affirm the non-identity of thought and being, hence turn towards materialism. Therefore, religion, relation to God, which in Hegel was, let's say, a legitimate form of self-recognition of man, became with late Feuerbach essentially one-sided relation of mis-self-recognition, of projection, of alienation of man. And so the Feuerbach broke the theoretical conditions of the debate between pantheism and personalism that were growing in post-Hegelian ambiguity. He finally decided that pantheism, whether naturalistic or rational Hegelian, is too first and foremost a theism, and therefore it must be abandoned in favor of materialism of a human being with its essential corporeality and senselessness. So this is how Feuerbach arrives at the position that leaves his flank open for later Marx criticism of Feuerbach in Tetris von Feuerbach. We must note that some of the Marxist criticism, while perhaps adequate criticism of late Feuerbach's theory of alienation, are not a completely fair presentation of his thought as a whole. Marx, for example, reproaches to Feuerbach abstract individualism or atomistic view of man. So, and these were actually things that Feuerbach himself very much opposed throughout his life. His thought in general definitely wasn't asocial, ahistorical. He definitely noticed the correlation between atomistic self-conception of man and certain personalist religious beliefs. The problem was that his general critical theory of religion, presented in Essence of Christianity, was shaped by his particular struggle with personalism, and therefore it seems that it has reproduced some of its features. Feuerbach's critique of personalism functioned only as long as he remained within more or less idealist Hegelian framework without difference of thought and being. So he needn't concern himself with what is here causally primary. But when he at last decided that he must abandon idealism and he described alienation as alienation from material, from sensuous life, which is ontologically and normatively somehow primary, he didn't notice that this new ontology should also apply to his philosophy itself. Marx's critique of Feuerbach is essentially a metacritique. Marx applied the criteria taken from Feuerbach to Feuerbach himself. Feuerbach criticized religion as an alienation from ontologically and more primary sensus corporeal level of existence, but did not consider that then the possibility of alienation should be explained from this level of sensus life itself. And this is the point that Marx has grabbed and developed. Or in other words, early Marx materialism isn't so much a continuation of Feuerbach's materialism, but more resolving the incoherence of Feuerbachian materialism. So how is it important regarding our topic of religion? Now we can see that Marx's abandonment of religion and its critique was not the result of completely linear intellectual progress. Rather, a certain swerving away that happened. Feuerbach's confrontation with religion led him to articulation of a critique that was untenable and gave impulse to Marx to make it consistent by further directing his studies towards the empirical social reality. And of course, Marx then discovered the strength of economic forces which structure society without being consciously represented. And this is, of course, a definite characteristic of capitalism, of modernity, the crucial change from pre-capitalist, religion-based social order. But at the same time, we have to note that the pre-Marxian critique of religion was not simply attacking a wrong and already defeated enemy. The pre-Marxian critique of religion was only possible because the religion itself already accommodated to the new economico-political transformation, and in its personalist atomizing form served as representation of early capitalist social structure. However, at the same time, when religion was with Marx abandoned as a point of theoretical political struggle, something else has disappeared. The tendency of utopianism, the tendency to articulate the prospective new social order in terms of realization of kingdom of heaven of earth. Up until Feuerbach's materialist turn, such interweaving of political utopia and realization of religion has been commonplace in thinkers like Heine, Hayes, Ruge, Saint-Simonians in general. So here we have to consider that in the early 19th century, this interweaving of political utopia and religious discourse didn't mean that you base your politics on some mythical prophecy. It merely meant that you conceive your political project as something total, as something universally compelling. So perhaps for this reason, we shouldn't consider this religious utopianism something totally anachronistic. We should perhaps turn the perspective, and we should ask ourselves, how exactly did the left, post-Marxian left, manage to do without such theological religious discourse when articulating and justifying its grand projects. Now, in conclusion, I'll actually try to establish a certain link with contemporary political situation. So, first, a review: what replaced this theologizing political utopianism in post-Marxian thought? roughly speaking, for quite some time, a secularized scientific version of such theological millennialism was operative, namely the theology of stages of historical development that is supposed to necessarily lead to socialism or communism. And then later on, when organized mass left parties became a strong enough social force, actually you didn't really need any universally acceptable justification of leftist project anymore, because political project could simply be conceived as growing out of the immanence of the class struggle itself, simply conceived as an emancipation of a determined yet universal subject, proletariat. And then, of course, now we are somewhere after World War II. The left obviously gravitated either towards total inclusion in the system or towards the margins. In neither of the cases, and they talk about the absolutes, the historical necessities, and the theology was necessary. And then, of course, for some, for a couple of decades, any idea of grand left project remained completely suspended. Well, in recent 3 years, however, something at least moved. We have witnessed an emergence of the left, of a new left, or perhaps a 20th century left. I don't think it has a name yet. I'm trying to refer to emergence of leftist movements and parties that at least attempt to be at once radical and attempt to be mainstream. And this is actually quite a new phenomenon that for quite some time, and of course it presents some quite novel challenges. First and foremost, challenge of legitimation. Obviously, to be mainstream, you have to be able to articulate your specific position in universally acceptable and recognized terms. And to be radical means precisely to be somewhat in disagreement with those same universally accepted and recognized terms. So how do you solve this dilemma? And I think that in the absence of possibility of any new millennialist utopias, or in the absence of possibility of class struggle voluntarism, there has been a noticeable tendency for these new left projects to fall back on some superficial common sense enlightenment position, heavy relying on the signifier on reason, on reasonableness as the certain basic common denominator of modernity. To illustrate, I'm thinking here, for example, of let's say Varoufakis style of political activism, or in general the Keynesian arguments, which all rely on describing themselves as the only reasonable position, as opposed to neoclassical or neoliberal dogmatism, blindness, or destructiveness. For example, from a local political stage, and representative quote from the context of migrant crisis with the new barriers rising throughout Europe, and quote, the left remained the only voice of reason which opposed that. And a final example along the same lines, I noticed that among the many points on which Bernie Sanders' campaign was attacked, was also apparently his use of the words insane and crazy for description of Republican policies. And so he was attacked from the Clinton side that this is ableist discourse that shows his disregard for people with mental health issues. Unfortunately, I'm running out of time, so I'll have to keep these thoughts quite undeveloped. I'm more throwing out this thesis, this diagnosis of contemporary politics as a possible point of debate. But in general, I would like to commend that this aggressive emphasis on signifier of reason, not so much on reason, but on signifier of reason as a source of legitimation, while it is understandable, it has its own weaknesses. Quite soon, it can start to appear not so much a sign of self-confidence, but a quite desperate attempt of self-assurance. Because to monopolize the position of reason to oneself simultaneously means to banish all the forces of opposition into the realm of unreasonable unthinkability. So I think the flip side of this position is another quite prevalent contemporary leftist attitude, namely certain catastrophism, certain enjoyment in declaring, describing the imminence of an apocalypse. And I believe there's in the background there's some psychological mechanism of self-assurance at work, in the sense that if we lose, things will be so absolutely unthinkably wrong that they are too terrible to complicate. There are some apocalypse will happen either in form of total collapse of the system, or slide into fascism, slide into barbarism. But I think that what such attitude, what's the true internal economy of such attitude, is that it tries to avoid confronting an even more horrible option, that there might be no apocalypse, no collapse, in the sense that there might be no radical event, that the tendency of the system that we fight against have their own persistent logic, so that we might be brought to a position where we have to endure them not as apocalypse, but as normalcy. So, so this tendency of catastrophism is a refusal to acknowledge that the forces opposing us might have some objective historical reality, some persistent logic, that they can actually function. And the problem is that they very likely do have such internal logic, and failure to acknowledge that might prove to be politically fatal. So what I'm here suggesting is not that reason and rationality as legitimation strategies should be abandoned, only that reason behaves quite specifically as a legitimation strategy, and that its careless employment can precisely result in some new dogmatism or a certain negative political theology of catastrophe. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Martin. And now it's Rachel's turn, and afterwards we go to the question.
Hegel's philosophy has always created division amongst his followers. However, the fierce opposition between different camps of Hegelians are not like the disagreements that arise in scholarship on any other philosopher. It is not accidental that the response to Hegel's thought enacts the very irreconcilable split that he saw within spirit. The divisions that arise out of the arguments about the correct reading of Hegel are performatively more correct than any single side of these debates concerning his content. This split cannot be avoided, although we try and fail to overcome it again and again. The first split in Hegel scholarship occurred immediately during Hegel's own lifetime. On one side of the division were the old Hegelians, who saw Hegel's philosophy as the haggard owl that swoops down to survey the end of history, which is upon us. And their opponents, the young Hegelians, saw Hegel's philosophy as the fledgling cock that welcomes the dawn of a new stage, which is upon us. The hostile division between the old and the young is already quite comical. Two faces of Hegel knocking heads within the same historical crack. So I'll illustrate this for you in the form of two Hegelian haikus. Two Hegelians in a crack. Is this the end or the beginning? Neither sees that what one calls owl and one calls cock is the same damn bird. The split between the old and the young Hegelians is often framed in terms of the former's defense of Hegel's philosophy as the ultimate expression of Christian metaphysics, in the latter's rejection of the theological aspects of Hegel's thought in the name of revolutionary politics. The young Hegelians, however, were neither united in their political vision nor in their views on religion. In fact, it was precisely their disagreements concerning the relationship between religion and politics that both drove their dialogue and divided them. The common factor that united the Hegelian left was rather the way they drew on Hegel's aesthetics as a lens to view modern social and political life. Of all the moments in Hegel's extensive history of aesthetics, the young Hegelians took inspiration from Hegel's analysis of the art religion of the Greeks, giving particular attention to Hegel's reading of ancient Greek comedy. Within their political writings, this single historical moment within Hegel's phenomenology of spirit was elevated to characterize the dramatic movement of history itself. The young Hegelians identified comedy as the internal motor of history, the work of the negative, and gave this historical comedy a second name, critique. As a political movement, the young Hegelians didn't even last two decades. They came together in the first revolutions of 1830s and dispersed after the failed revolution of 1848. They collectively celebrated the first series of small uprisings as the opening of a great historical comedy. As they saw it, revolution is born when a historical stage can no longer look at its own tragic contradictions with a straight face. Revolution is history's laughter. Arnold Ruge, one of the founding members, only half joked when he claimed that it was due to the gloominess, or what is more accurate, the brutishness of the feeling in German spirit, that its own revolution lagged behind the historical laughter of countries like France, which had already experienced their own comic eruptions. With the uprisings of the 1830s, the young Hegelians sensed that Germany would soon erupt in its own comedy. As Ruge put it, "We will now be able to detect among ourselves this emergence of a historical comedy, which, unlike the genre comedy, does not destroy the shapes of bourgeois spirit, but that destroys the spirit's actual historical stages." The young Hegelians came together with the anticipation of a great historical comedy. However, the culmination of the uprisings of the 30s and 40s and the failures of the 1848 inspired little laughter. This time history repeated itself, first as comedy and then as tragedy, revealing the comic nature of the beginning as merely farce. The young Hegelians, most of whom had been silenced, kicked out of the university, sent into exile and imprisoned, dispersed with their comic spirits thoroughly crushed. Despite their own dismal fate, however, one of their most powerful legacies is their comic framing of critique, which later becomes central for 20th century critical theory and psychoanalysis. And yet, during their own short run, their notion of critique was split by their divided views on the relationship between comedy and religion, which produced yet another split within Hegel scholarship. Already within the first generation of Hegels, there was a crack within a crack, a full turn of the dialectical screw. The first division between the old and the young can be formulated as the crack between the defenders of the seriousness of religion and the defenders of the comedy of religion. And yet this latter phrase, the comedy of religion, synonymous with the critique of religion, was immediately divided. The double genitive lends itself to two opposing senses of the comedy of religion. In the first sense, the comedy of religion, religion is the object of critique. The joke is on religion when the critical philosopher lifts religion's skirt, exposing its empty content. In the second sense of the comedy of religion, critique belongs to religion itself. Religion is the exhibitionist who lifts her own skirt, and religion makes the joke, exposing its own contradiction, and in so doing, sabotages the state that sought to appropriate it. The first model posits critique as the destructive power that's applied to the object of laughter. The second model suggests that to be transformative, critique must take the form of self-critique. Laughter must arise from the crack of the contradiction itself. These two sides of the comedy of religion arise out of a concentrated debate that takes place primarily between Marx, Max Stirner, and Ruge over the years of 1842 and 1843. To my knowledge, Marx was the first to introduce the theme of comedy into young Hegelian discourse in the winter of 1842. His first coming out essay as a young Hegelian, an explicit defense of the critical value of humor over and against Prussian seriousness. That summer, Stirner and Ruge respond to Marx's essay, offering their own framings of historical comedy. Stirner in his essay, Art and Religion, and Ruge in Hegel's Philosophy of Right and the Politics of Our Time. These two essays establish opposite poles of the comedy of religion. Stirner imagines the comic destruction of religion at the hands of critical philosophy, which he saw as a purely negative force. Ruge marks religion as a potential comic stage that could give birth to revolutionary destruction. Both Stirner and Ruge saw religion as a hollow corpse, which lacked life in itself, since people had become totally indifferent towards it. However, while Stirner sought to destroy the ghostly corpse of religion, Ruge sought to resuscitate religion to recover its radical capacity. These two competing versions of the comedy of religion inspire Marx's second formulation of comic critique in the contribution to Hegel's philosophy of writing. This initial discourse on religion, comedy, and critique remains the ground of Marx's later writing. He returns to the theme of comedy most explicitly 11 years later in 18th Brumaire, and performatively employs comedy throughout his corpus. Marx's work is constituted by this crack between the Hegelian left's comedy of religion and the Hegelian left identification of religion's comedy. In his first writings on Prussian censorship, Marx makes the provocative claim that the censorship of affect is at once the censorship of content, further claiming that comic affects, such as irreverence, audacity, and humor, are the content of critical speech. In 1842, the 1842 censorship, entitled Laws on the Freedom of the Press, was an amendment to the censorship laws established in 1819. The original censorship named a series of subjects that could not be criticized by the press. The new amendment claimed to release the public from these temporary strictures, declaring it unlawful to censor serious and modest investigations of the truth. It went on to address the individual articles of the 1819 law, lifting the former limitations on the content of critique. However, the right to the freedom of expression only applied to speech's subject matter. The censorship was instead redirected to focus on the spirit in which such critiques were delivered, and took the ambiguous task of monitoring what was identified as certain extreme or disruptive tendencies of different kinds of speech. For example, the amendment states that laws can no longer prevent the media from conducting frank discussions of international affairs of the Prussian state. However, such discussions must also take caution to present the state in a favorable light. In other instances, the amendment states that the law can no longer silence critiques of religion. However, a serious critique of Christianity must also avoid sounding too frivolous or too hostile. Conversely, a religious body can no longer be prevented from voicing disapproval of the state, but any opposition must not adopt a tone that is too fanatical. While the 1819 law directly dictated what subjects of public speech are legitimate or illegitimate, the 1842 amendment made a polite appeal for objective and respective public discourse. Affects or tones such as frivolity or hostility, two modes of humorous speech as Marx points out, were identified as a threat to the need for frank and decent public speech. At first glance, the 1842 amendment, which both lists the former strictures on speech and claims to create a civil environment for public debate, may seem laudable. Who can object to the call for philosophical discourse that is open and polite to all perspectives, or the call for religious discourse that is tolerant and measured, the call for the media to be frank and objective? Yet as Marx sees it, this appearance of fostering an atmosphere conducive to serious critical inquiry is more deceptive than laws that directly inhibit what we may say or do. It is precisely when we believe that we are free that ideology has its strongest hold. As Marx writes, "You may write freely, but at the same time, every word must be a curtsy to liberal censorship, which allows you to express your equally serious and modest opinions. Indeed, do not lose your feeling of reverence." In Marx's view, the dispositions of seriousness and modesty are antithetical to critical discourse. The modesty of the objective reporter disguises his own biases as he presents his findings as a collection of facts. And what is more arrogant than humility? The seriousness of the institutional philosopher's reverence for his work and field prevents him from calling into question the deep-seated bourgeois values that form his own methodology. And what is funnier than the one who takes himself too seriously? As Marx declares, seriousness, serious and modest, what fluctuating relative concepts? Where does serious cease and jocularity begin? Where does modesty cease and immodesty begin? If you want to be consistent, forbid also too serious and too modest investigation of the truth. For too great seriousness is the most ludicrous thing of all. And too great modesty is the bitterest irony. Marx insists that when seriousness and modesty are given as the proper attitudes of one seeking truth, a third epistemic affect is suppressed, and that's humor. Marx identifies humor as a political affect specifically because it challenges the attitude of reverence. Insisting that one approaches laws or norms with reverence prohibits one from approaching them at all. Further, the greatest threat to critique in Marx's view is boredom. A serious and modest investigation, which lacks the ability to incite laughter at the absurdity of the object critique, also lacks the ability to excite not only the audience, but the author herself. I am humorous, Marx declares, but the law bids me to write seriously. I am audacious, but the law commands me to be modest. Gray, all gray, is the sole and rightful color of freedom. When critical thought takes itself too seriously, it grows bored with itself and forgets its real material power to destroy the contradictions that it observes. Critique gains power when it has the audacity to laugh in the face of that which it once upheld with reverence. As Marx puts it, I treat ludicrous seriously when I treat it ludicrously. Stirner's Art and Religion picks up Marx's critique of the dispositions of seriousness, humility, and reverence. Stirner develops Marx's position, arguing that the liberal imperative for serious critical inquiry is modeled after Christian worship. Although the worshiper seeks to know the will of God, she must do so with absolute humility and reverence. The ways of the Lord, she admits, are beyond her comprehension, and yet it is her duty to continually chase after the unattainable mysteries of the divine. In both secular academy and in the church, the attitude of reverence constitutes the relationship between the subject and object, an object of inquiry or adoration. The desire for the object of knowledge, or the object of love, is maintained as long as the object is kept out of reach. However, what appears to be the disunion between subject and object are instances of self-alienation. Although we seek to know the source of our pleasures and pain, the political and economic structures that shape our lives seem to always be beyond human comprehension. The unobtainable object of the knower and believer is herself. Many philosophers, including Plato, Aristotle, Descartes, Hobbes, and Adam Smith, identify wonder, or reverence, as the primary epistemic motion that drives our desire for knowledge. Stirner and Marx, in contrast, argue that the spirit of awe makes us worshippers rather than critical thinkers. Stirner argues that the state is maintained by this secular form of worship. The problem is not that our education, news sources, and popular media tell us what to think, but rather that they train us how to feel when we think, which prevents us from really thinking. We are taught to make our inquiries with religious affects of seriousness and reverence, which make us good citizens who are always too humble to challenge that which we cannot possibly comprehend. In Stirner's view, critique becomes possible when we break the seal of seriousness, laughing in the face of humility itself. If the status quo is preserved through reverence and seriousness, then the destructive power of critique must be born out of irreverent laughter. As Stirner writes, critique appears at the decline of religion, as the trifling of the full seriousness of that old belief, a seriousness of content which religion has now lost, in which we must return to the joyful poet. Hence religion is presented as a ridiculous comedy. Now, however terrible this comedic destruction might be, it will nevertheless restore to actuality that which it seeks to destroy. And so, we do not elect to condemn its horror. In contrast to Stirner, who saw comedy as the destruction of the preservation of religious affect in the secular sphere, Ruge identified the church as the site where such destructive laughter could first erupt. If the place of the worshiper was no longer the house of God, but the secular world of capital, then the church could be transformed into the temple of the iconoclast. The church gave birth to the spirit of the worshiper, which became the spirit of capital. So too could the church give birth to the blasphemous spirit of comedy, which would also outgrow religion, becoming the spirit of revolution. A according to Hegel, this had already occurred once within pagan religion. The tragic stage on which the individual was sacrificed for her abstract and impersonal universal ideals became the site for comic demystification and destruction of that old tragic order. Ruge saw religion as the modern parallel for Greek theatrical stage. Unlike other disciplines, which are defined by their particular object, religion, like the theatrical stage, is without its own proper object. Its content is rather the creative action of historical actors. In Stirner's analysis, the structure of alienation is theological and is later appropriated by the state to maintain its power. Ruge reverses this order. Because the content of religion is historical existence itself, the contradiction found within religion reflects the contradictions belonging to a much broader political stage. Religion, like the Greek stage, is thus a mirror for social and political life. Comedy doesn't directly oppose tragedy, but repeats and therefore magnifies the contradiction concealed on the tragic stage. This self-destruction, Ruge noted, religion could play out its comedy if it took itself more seriously. This self-destruction would at once transform religion into the stage for the highest form of art, which is that which breaks out directly into self-critique. It is its comedy. Marx's second formulation of comedy and critique in his contribution of the Critique of Hegel's Philosophy of Right shifts from his earlier emphasis on critique as a kind of opposition that laughs down the oppressor to critique as a form of self-critique. In this version of comedy, we find a deeper sense of negation. In other words, the comedy of revolution must erupt out of the unbearable tension of a historical stage's own tragic conditions. Tragedy and comedy take place on the same stage. The Greeks told an ancient origin tale about the gods laughing creation into existence. According to the myth, all of historical existence is nothing but a joke of the gods. Marx beats Nietzsche to the modern German reversal of the ancient origin tale. While the ancient gods may have laughed materiality into existence, it is now time for the ancient gods to laugh themselves again. Laugh themselves to death. As Marx famously states, history is thorough and passes through many phases when it conveys an old form to the grave. The final phase of a world historical form is its comedy. The Greek gods, already mortally wounded, tragically had to die once more comically. Why does history proceed this way? So that mankind will separate itself happily from its past. Religion had already died in the hearts of the people who had become indifferent towards their own belief. And yet, the hollow shell of Christianity was preserved not only in the lingering religious practice, but in the secular appropriation of the state. The first death of the god was tragic because God simply nodded off while sitting on his eternal throne. In other words, people had grew indifferent towards their own belief, which Protestantism had made a private affair. In order to die comically and thoroughly, God had to be woken up and told that he was dead. God had to first learn that he had died so that he could laugh himself to death properly. Religion had drifted off to sleep, and therefore it didn't resist when it was appropriated by the state. In order for the tragic conditions of religion to play out its comedy, this contradiction first had to be actualized. As Ruge argued, the goal of critique is not the destruction of the seriousness of belief. Instead, it was to make religion the site of its own comic critique, precisely by taking religion more seriously than religion takes itself. As Ruge put it, the practical pathos of religion is much more powerful than the defenders of religion think. To take religion more seriously than religion takes itself is to make religion actualize its own contradictions. This is to force religion to carry out its own logic and to expose its own contradictions as farcical. In Marx's words, these petrified conditions must be made to dance by singing to their own melody. However, to force religion to play out its farcical content on its own stage endows it not merely oh, it doesn't merely destroy religion, but endows it with its own transformative power of comic critique. Marx's formulation of the double death of gods is a reformulation of a critique as something that belongs to the tragic stage itself, when its contradictions arise to the surface. While the young Hegelians equated comedy with critique, Ruge's specific formulation of the destructive power of the negative within religion itself allows Marx to arrive at an understanding of comic critique as not proper to the philosopher, but proper to history itself. If each new stage of history is constituted by a deep internal contradiction, as Hegel saw it, comedy is the negative power that brings this crack to the surface. The young Hegelians draw on the laughing gods of Greek art religion to arrive at their own image of historical laughter, as opposed to the sacred laughter of theology that renders creativity as a positive force, the profane laughter of history, which can be heard at times even from within the church, reveals the creativity of critique as a self-destructive generating force.
Okay, and now if we may have the lights so we can gather the questions. I saw one usual suspect and another question also. So, Tibor, please.
Hello, yeah. So, thank you all for these really brilliant contributions. I really enjoyed this afternoon. I have a lot of questions, but one which is more a question of understanding to you, Jarne, with the Spinoza issue. My question is, don't we have to distinguish between the God or gods issues on one hand and the religion issue on the other hand? Not only in the Durkheimian sense that there are religions without gods and so on, but also in the strict sense of your suggestion of a strategy. Because if I understand you correctly, Spinoza used the strategy of over-affirmation of a non-exclusive God in order to destroy an exclusive religion. But the schizo is an over-affirmative guy who over-affirms capitalism, which is in itself already non-exclusive. Yeah? So, does this really work? That would be my question. Or can you, by over-affirmation, only always destroy an exclusive object, whereas with a non-exclusive object, you become like swallowed of its own over-affirmation?
I will try to be short because it's a really complicated issue, but at the second part of my talk I wanted to stress out that I think that capitalism is exclusive, that this is exactly the point, and that we have to show how it is exclusive, and that all this talk about how are we all equal in front of market and so on, that this of course should not be taken seriously. So, but if we affirm capitalism in those way that it should not exclude, what will this imply in concrete practice? I can hardly answer, but for example, let's say it abstractly. For me, the problem is not just the question no state or full and very powerful state. I see this as a two ways to the same goal. But the problem is exactly the minimal state as it is right now, or this because this invisible hand is actually not so invisible. So maybe it would, for example, Martin mentioned Varoufakis, maybe he could also said, for example, yeah, you are talking about free market, but it's actually not free. We have some secret commissions and some secret tables where things are decided and so on. We have these trade agreements, international trade agreements, and so on. And this is also not in favor of this really invisible, totally invisible hand of the market. So in certain sense, I don't see this, let's say, anarcho-capitalism, but not this actual, but some other version of it. I'm not totally cynical to those positions. If we go really till the end of this neoliberal dogma, no state, no external intervention, okay, but this dogma, should we should say that this to neoliberals themselves, yeah, you should not try to intervene in the market because they are doing this.
All right. Is this working? Can I maybe jump with the question there, since the other microphone does not seem to be working? So I enjoyed this panel quite a lot myself. I wanted to add two comments. One is to what Mirt was saying, which is just a short comment. You said that Aaron Schuster introduced this idea of the invisible hand job of the market, but that it was kind of a slip of the tongue. I just want to assure everyone that it was not a slip of the tongue. It was quite deliberate, though he did not elaborate on it, and I guess it was wonderful that you did all this transition from theology of the market to the pornography of the market or whatever. But my question is like Robert's on Spinoza as well, on Spinoza's atheism. And my comment is this, there's usually two understandings of Spinoza's atheism, if we do not count in Hegel's reading, which is that Spinoza was not atheist at all, that if anything, Spinoza was a cosmist, but let's leave Hegel to decide. Now, the usual explanations are this. First, the one you sort of advocated, which is to say that, well, basically he's a theologian, he has a mask of theologian, but actually he's an atheist. He hates God and everything, but he just uses this word in order to promote certain goals, certain theoretical strategies. And then there's the other understanding, the alternative, which is that Spinoza is not atheist, but he somehow is a pantheist, and he somehow sees nature, he deifies nature. Now, of course, the second understanding is completely ridiculous, and I totally am happy that you went away from that. However, I would like to say that maybe this simple alternative of going away from deifying nature does not necessarily mean of being an atheist with a mask. I think Spinoza's strategy or philosophical task is rather to recognize that there is a word, God, the word God, which does function the way it functions. There is a word, which is not just a word among other words, but it's a word that kind of organizes an entire hierarchy of other words and concepts and so on. So Spinoza's strategy would be basically, you know, his question is not whether or not God exists. His question is what exactly do we mean when we say God? And this is basically what first level of knowledge it is. I mean, this is what Althusser calls Spinoza's theory of ideology. But, you know, so basically, I would say that not that he's an atheist, but that he's a materialist. And, you know, his question is not of atheism, theism, or panentheism, or pantheism, but a question of materialism. So this would be my comment to, or two comments to what was said. Sorry for jumping.
Will you reply to the comments again? No. So, now please get the working mic to the eager public.
Yeah, okay, I can. Of course, I can respond. I think that that I agree, and that I don't think that this question, atheist with a mask or atheist without a mask, is crucial. Definitely, he as a person, he was deeply religious. He believed in he has a very special, because we cannot otherwise understand why he was so passionate, and he even his life was in danger because of his beliefs and so on. And he was really in a sense that his belief should directly correspond with his practice. So he couldn't obey to the religious authorities, but he said, if I'm religious, I have to do this. And this is actually, I think, very connected with this materialistic thesis that you mentioned. Yeah, that God is manifesting in nature. There is no God outside nature, and so religion must be manifested in the religious or faithful action. And that is, how to say, his personal religion. So I agree, there is, it's the question between whether God exists or doesn't exist. I think this is not an important question in this case, but I think that the effect of Spinoza thought was atheistic, even if he doesn't see himself as an atheist.
Well, I just wanted to comment that I find Martin's last remarks or thesis very interesting. I mean, this with that we are hoping for a catastrophe and so on. I was also like recently thinking a lot about it. And so we are somehow hoping for it mostly from two points, because then it would be really obvious that we have been right the whole time about the system, and also then in case of the catastrophe, then we would certainly be able to like organize the crowds and stuff. I mean, if we're not able to do this now, then we really would be. So, and I'm also afraid that you're right, that probably this catastrophe won't happen, so the system will manage somehow. So so my question is, what do you think would be the correct alternative, like state of the mind? And well, my impression is that we simply have to learn how to organize people in this current situation and how to do politics properly.
Okay, the precise logic that I envisage is slightly different. Not that we actually hope for catastrophe, because that would be kind of too late then. And let's say that it's such a catastrophe that there are no crowds left to organize at all, and that we do not really enjoy being right if catastrophe happens. But just that that this is a strategy to remove, let's say, political defeat from the realm of the thinkable and therefore for the possible. So I, in the sense that if we don't succeed, such a catastrophe will happen that that it cannot happen, that this course of events is, well, we can disregard it in a sense. It's something too terrible to even consider to be too, in the sense that, yeah, you just sort of absolve yourself from the necessity of certain effort of thought. So my prescription is precisely not to be afraid to actually think as this, you know, that instead of imagining catastrophe, try to think this catastrophe, and in the sense that, well, that precisely doesn't, that makes it uncatastrophic in a sense, because the notion of catastrophe that I use here means precisely to make something unthinkable. The idea is not to be afraid to make this unfortunate course of events thinkable, and in the sense that recognize that, well, it's not a matter of reason winning or catastrophe happening. I mean, also the negative course of events can have certain reason to it. That's for me the problem of this reasonabilistic strategy, rationalistic strategy, in the sense that,
For example, there, in the context of Europe, for example, there's a lot of arguments how the current Euro architecture is completely untenable. It constantly goes into the crisis, and at some point it will collapse. This collapse is referred, however. To recognize that this might be actual, always imminent, the persistent imminence of collapse might be the actual functioning logic of the system, in that sense.
Okay, any more questions? Yeah.
Okay, hello, Martin Autour. At the end, talking about so that the left is trying to conceive itself as a barrier of the rationalistic tradition whatsoever, I find it rather problematic actually, because also the imperialist projects were part of that, and also the capitalist construction of Europe more or less was also part of the rational movement. So it's ambivalent, I think, at least.
Yes, of course, but okay. I mean, the rationality is extremely vague term. Of course, you have, and generally, I think that the left shouldn't disregard this enlightened position or get rid of it, because it's not much, but it is one of the things that it has, and in a sense that I think that left does justifiably claim it, in a sense that that it tries to always create a subject where this rationality could affect itself. And so, not to say that the capitalism is similarly based on certain rationality, or that colonialism was based on certain rationality. I mean, that's a bit too vague, of course.
Not rationality, but it was a project of enlightenment also. You know, I'm not trying to argue against your position,
yeah.
I'm just trying to introduce the other part that comes with it.
We always already have to acknowledge the fact that yes, the European Enlightenment wasn't good for everyone.
Vaguely said.
Thanks.
Well, I have the usual rejoinder to this that Enlightenment might have happened in Europe, but it is uncertain. And of course, in the process, the Europe conquered the rest of the world. Did some very bad things, but it's not. You can't exactly blame Enlightenment for that. You can divorce it from its point of origin to a certain extent. I mean, it's wrong to conceive the Enlightenment as a uniquely European feature event, I think. I mean, the proper way to conceive the Enlightenment is that it happened in Europe, but that was more or less contingent. So I think that there exists a universalism that's actually universal, even though of course you always have to be careful not to fall into the trap of a false universalism that are not universal and that are high subjugation.
Yeah. One last question for Rachel. No one asked you actually a question, there are lots of questions. First of all, there was a very fascinating paper, but I have a question on laughter and critique, and maybe it's not so much on religion. In our age, where we have basically not... how do we can play out the critical potential of laughter and comedy in light of, in the face of farcical characters? So if you have basically kind of an evil clown, think of politicians like, you already almost forgotten Berlusconi, but also if you look at the current so-called religious phenomena like we heard in the earlier session, ISIS, people who don't take themselves seriously, of course, have to perform a certain seriousness that they perform, that others, that they pretend that others believe on their behalf that they are serious. So when you have this kind of split character of farcical, not comedy, how can you laugh at the face of such people? In the old days, when you had at least real authority, you could play out that young Hegelian, Marxian, Stirnerian laughter.
Yeah, I think Marx definitely already addresses this, because I think someone like Stirner, he puts seriousness and laughter in just oppositional relationships. Where serious, the authority takes themselves very seriously, and we laugh at them, challenge their authority, and to disrupt their divinity in a way, to tear down the guards. But I think Marx is already complicating this, where when he says, I take ludicrous seriously, but treating it ludicrously, where seriousness and laughter are already in a dialectical relationship. And I guess this point about how when we feel that we're free is actually when ideology has its strongest hold. And certainly laughter gives us that sort of feeling of freedom. So part of this, I think, also is from the perspective of an authority who can make a joke about themselves. And somehow, if they make a joke about themselves, they're outside of the critique of themselves. Because they're in on the critique. And they're just like, well, I'm aware of this, too. So an authority that can make a joke of themselves somehow escapes the critique by being in on the critique. So I'm losing my train of thought, in a way. So I think laughter can be the mirror of seriousness. Not just the opposite. So when comedy is just presented as an opposition to tragedy or to seriousness, it actually mirrors the same conditions. So it takes the new form. The form of laughter can preserve the content of that sort of seriousness or tragedy in a way. But talking about contemporary sort of strategies to this, I'm not sure.